Hi, everybody. We're just waiting for everyone to come into the room, so we'll just wait a few more minutes. Hi. Hi, everybody. We are just waiting one more minute and then we'll start. So just letting everyone into the room. Okay. Okay. So I'll start. So good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the GCRF AgriFood Africa Virtual Missions. My name is Pedro Carvalho, and I'm a knowledge transfer manager in the AgriFood team at KTN. My background is crop science, and this afternoon's session is the last session of this series of webinars that we've been running in the summer, and is focused on major crops. The session will start with a Q&A panel session with experts in the area and then in the field, and then we'll follow it up by breakout rooms where all of you will have the opportunity to join in the discussion. If you have any questions for the panelists, please type them into the chat box and I will try to ask as many of them as possible depending on timing. This session will be recorded and we'll make it available on our YouTube page so you can rewatch it at your leisure, pause it. And then on the same channel, you will be able to find the recordings of previous sessions. What else I would like to tell you, I would also like to encourage you to network with each other. So today from 2:30 to 4:30 p.m., there will be a networking event through the Meeting Mojo platform, and we'll pass the link to the chat box. So I would like to start our panel session by introducing our speakers. So I would like to start with Taita. So if you could just introduce yourself, please.
Hi. My name is Taita, and I'm the co-founder of Illuminum Greenhouses. At Illuminum, we provide farmers with smart greenhouses that are equipped with smart sensors that allow them to automate irrigation as well as access modern farming technologies.
Thank you very much, Taita. Philip Abrahams, can you please introduce yourself?
Yes, good morning, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Phil Abrahams. I'm Strategic Business Development Director at Cabi. Cabi is an intergovernmental organization working in plant health, invasive species, and helping smallholders access trade markets. Looking forward to speak to you.
Thank you, Phil. David Chikoye, can you please introduce yourself?
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is David Chikoye. I'm the IITA Regional Director for Southern Africa. I'm based in Lusaka, Zambia. As IITA, we are a member of the Consultative Group on International Agricultural Research. Our focus is on breeding. We are actually working on main four thematic areas, that is crop improvement, plant protection, agribusiness. So my background is in agronomy, and I'm actually happy to participate in this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you very much, David. And last but not least, Carolien van Zyl from Villa Crop Protection. Could you please introduce yourself?
Hi, Pedro. Thanks for the opportunity to take part in this discussion. I'm a product development specialist at Villa Crop Protection, and my specific focus is on insecticides. Villa is a South African entity providing a range of crop protection solutions, and I form part of a team that's responsible for registration of new products, as well as maintaining a range of in-house products and their registrations. Thanks.
Thank you all for your introductions. I will now open the discussion by asking some general questions, and then if we have time, we will go to more specific questions to each of the panelists. So I would like to start with a very general question. So, and I will start by asking you, David, what do you think the main challenges to crop production in sub-Saharan Africa are? David?
Okay, thank you, Pedro. Yeah, I've classified these in four categories. The first one being issues around natural resource management. We have issues of soil management, land degradation. We have issues around water management. Then if I move forward, some of the challenges relate to the effects of abiotic stresses. These are due to diseases, pests, and weeds. You see, we produce whatever little we produce. We at times, you know, we lose it to post-harvest losses. Right now, some of the statistics show that, you know, you have about 40% in terms of post-harvest losses. And in terms of post-harvest losses, you see, we lack the infrastructure for storage. We even also lack technologies for food preservation. Some of the constraints and challenges, I've actually lumped them under the socioeconomic factors. These include policies. You know, we have policies that kind of favor certain crops, especially the staple crop like maize here where I am in Southern Africa. You know, the government, they provide subsidy programs. We have buying agencies, again, which are subsidized by government. There's a lot of private sector investment, you know, that at times works at the expense of other crops, which are non-focused by the available policies. We have issues of poor linkages between research and extension. You know, always the general thinking was that research will produce products and then the extension will pick it and then carry it on to the farmers. Yeah. We have unstable prices for commodities. You know, always at the harvest time, for example, maize prices will be very low, only to get high later on. We have issues around credit and financing of agriculture. In general, also, I think the actually low investments in agriculture research, especially pertaining to issues that affect small-scale farmers. The last one I'll talk about is the most of the agriculture in Africa is actually driven by small-scale farmers, especially for staple food production. But the reality on the ground is that most of these people are aging. And then we have the other problem that the young ones, the young energetic youth are not too interested in venturing in agriculture because they find it unattractive. Then maybe also let me comment related to that issue is that, you know, we have these diseases like HIV and malaria that also affect labor productivity because most of our production in Africa is labor intensive. There's actually little mechanization, especially for smallholder production systems. Let me end here.
Thank you very much, David. Carolien, do you want to expand on that? What are your views in terms of challenges to crop production? Oh, sorry, you are on mute, Carolien. Sorry.
There we go. Yes, Pedro, David touched on a few things that I actually wanted to mention that's quite relevant to South Africa as well. One of the things, firstly, it's climate. I think climate variability, we've had quite a few years of drought here in South Africa. This year would be better, but long dry spells and then what comes with it, stressed water resources as well. I think especially for from an exporter's point of view, rising input costs of products related to mechanization, whether that be tractors or implements, fertilizers, plant protection chemicals. And although South Africa remains a net exporter of agricultural products, a substantial share of the inputs required to produce a surplus is imported. And with the rand depreciating, the exchange rate supports commodity prices, but it does also result in higher input costs. And then I think from an export-orientated producer's point of view, maximum residue levels of pesticides can also pose a challenge. I won't say it's a problem. It's more of a challenge that can be managed. And therefore, well-designed spraying programs to manage these residues are quite essential to ensure that the chemical residues remain below accepted limits. And then I think also the rate of technological development. With technology developing faster than ever, the skills needed to make use and interpret as well as understand this technology is essential. And I think those are the three main things that are relevant to my area that I could think of.
Thank you very much. Phil, do you want to touch on this subject too?
Sure, thanks, Pedro. So Carolien and David have talked about pests and diseases, both post-harvest and pre-harvest. These are transboundary pests, indigenous pests. We've seen them hitting headlines over the years, fall armyworm, locust most recently, of course, but others as well, sort of stem and stalk borers, leaf spots, bean fly, white fly. They're all causing phenomenal economic damage to the core crops, but also a wider variety. Climate impacts are well documented. I think we need to look wider at the issue of soil fertility in Africa, soil loss, but also what's needed is a fundamental understanding of the soil microbiome if we're going to understand and improve the agricultural environment upon which we're growing on substrate. Other issues, capacity building. I think David talked about this. So capacity building for research and for training at multiple levels. Farmers don't get access to latest best practice thinking en masse. Advisors, extension in the public and private sector don't have access to that information. We're not attracting a new generation of students to actually want to work in agriculture, to become the next generation of teachers. So the ability to provide tools to help them build their professional capacity and then cascade customized, actionable and pragmatic advice to farmers that's both objective and scientifically sound. We at Cabi would like to see a more meaningful engagement of and adoption of safer treatments, biopesticides, to add to the portfolio of synthetic chemical products, bearing in mind the cupboard is bare in the synthetic agricultural marketplace, which is behind the setup of the Centre for Crop Health and Protection here in the UK, was to look at new candidates. There are other more fundamental issues, though, that I think need to be talked about. The lack of good governance is a problem across Africa, Asia, in certain, we have to point our fingers at, within Europe in certain cases as well. So there needs to be a committed and coordinated sense of investment for capacity building of local research, for that to be designed in Africa rather than parachuted in is critical. So access to resources, availability of courses, competency frameworks we see as being critical. And then fundamental issues like land rights, land management. Communities have taken or been granted ownership need commensurate training in how to manage their land and how to use the land that they've been given or granted by the government as a bargaining chip in accessing microcredit and finance And until all of these things get joined up into a system-based approach, I think we are at risk of doing projectized solutions rather than a holistic approach to deal with the problem. I'll end there, Pedro.
Thank you very much, Phil. Taita, can you just your views on this subject, please? Thanks.
I think the answers are very well laid out. It's pretty similar across sub-Saharan Africa. Maybe just to add on infrastructure, most of our farmers really suffer with having poor access roads or not having electric power to their farms in order to adopt mechanization and other production equipment. So I think poor infrastructure is indeed one of the problems that some smallholder farmers face across sub-Saharan Africa.
Thank you very much. So during these missions and these webinars, we talked a lot about technology, data, digital, satellite, drones, you name it. But in your experience, and starting with you, Taita, would just good agronomy be sufficient to increase yields across sub-Saharan Africa before we start touching all these brilliant technologies? But particularly for smallholder farmers, just how to grow the crops well, the basics. What do you think?
So good technology is not enough for smallholder farmers. I think we first need to understand that smallholder farmers have so many problems, just as we've just discussed right now. And most of the times we assume that technology would be the answer. But combining good agronomy and training with technology has created some positive results. Because one of the things you realize is that farmers need knowledge in order to know how to use an equipment or how to use a certain hybrid seed. They need knowledge on what inputs to apply, and that knowledge must be continually provided for. So we've realized that even if you provide knowledge transfer for just say 6 months or 1 year, farmers still need a reference point in the coming years because as technology develops, new things come up. So I think we need to always constantly leverage on both, having good agronomy, good training, running in tandem or at the same time with awareness of new machinery, awareness on new seeds, awareness on new mechanizations.
Thank you very much. Phil, training is something that Cabi does a lot. So in terms of agronomy, old school agronomy, how much influence do you think it can have on the agriculture in the region?
Well, good agronomy practices, good agricultural practices, of course, will always help, but they've always been there as well. So I suspect that the answer to your question is it's not enough in isolation. All of us have a duty to handhold our beneficiary farmers as they grow their knowledge and stay with them rather than being occasional dip-in partners. But I think we still see yields not being optimized. We still see farmers having nowhere to turn to because of the weakness of extension systems. No system is so weak, however, that it can't be improved through coordinated partnerships. I hope very much that the GCRF AgriFood for Africa stimulates those partnerships to help. What we see the need though is that unless we end up with a projectized approach to solutions, I said it in my previous comments, we need a systems-based approach. We need integrated plant health systems coupled with all the investment in the transport infrastructure that was mentioned as well. There are some key features that we see that need to be fulfilled that can't be fulfilled by one organization on its own though. A healthy, proactive plant health system needs to be predictive. We need systems that provide farmers with foresight and governments and agro input suppliers and manufacturers and food off-takers. What are the likely threats that are going to come in the coming season or seasons and prepare for them. So defending against imposing incoming threats, being proactive and prepared with systems to have smart and targeted surveillance in cropping systems for early detection, the ability to detect problems and to respond quickly. Being able to prevent, to get farmers aware of how to adopt appropriate pragmatic technologies to reduce their vulnerability, particularly when that's exacerbated by climate change. The ability to be responsive, to be able to react at scale and at speed, so that farmers are given just-in-time information rather than just-in-case information. That way we build up a partnership of trust with them, that we are warning them, and they can see that the alerts are relevant to their to what they see in the field. And then being able to provide the governments and the farmers and the private sector with quantitative information, evidence that we can show the social and economic impacts of what we are doing or the costs of not doing something, so that people can make choices about what technologies to buy, what technologies to prioritize, what services to adopt to help them.
Okay. Thank you very much for your comprehensive answer. And I'll move on to another question. David, can you hear me, David? David okay. said. Oh, okay.
Yes.
You got your audio back. Thank you.
Yeah.
So, what key technologies do you think can remediate the negative impact of climate change to crop production in the region?
Okay, maybe a couple of comments here. You see, like an institute like IITA, we've got a couple of breeders who are actually trying to breed for germplasm, improve varieties that respond to the multiple stresses imposed by climate change. These are droughts and heat stress, as well as responding to the disease pressure, which is arising from climate change. We also got a couple of agronomists who are also trying to put in an agronomic perspective, looking at issues that can actually conserve water, something like, you know, climate smart agriculture, where you use reduced tillage, mulching, as well as intercropping. Then we also need to borrow from some of the existing knowledge, local knowledge from farmers. Farmers do practice multiple cropping, you know. I always refer to my grandmother's garden, which had maize, millet, cassava, pumpkins, you know. It was actually a whole concoction of crops. And in that system, each crop actually kind of was able to perform under different climatic conditions. So the whole thing was that this was actually a risk management system, where if the main crop, maize, which is the staple crop, fails, you find that all these other minor crop might survive. And as a result, a farmer actually addresses the food security needs. I think in addition to that, what actually is needed is better climate and weather advisory services. Climate is changing. And remember, most of us are coming from some of the old recommendations. For example, here in Southern Africa, where actually you were told that, okay, plant your maize around November, December, okay? But what actually we need to enhance that information is that systems where actually they will tell you, that, okay, look, this year, the rain season is going to be delayed, and then maybe the rain duration will be shorter. So instead of going for traditional crop like maize, you might want to consider planting a short duration crop, for example, like cowpea or common beans. In addition to that, I think Yes, we know that breeding can breed, and agronomy maybe might be able to address some of these problems, especially if related to water management. But as Africa, I think we need to invest in irrigation. There is a point beyond which, you know, even a resistant cultivar, you know, will need water. So we cannot always think that these varieties are going to solve all the problems in any given situation. At least if we can have irrigation where farmers can start the crop, okay? And then later on, when the rains stabilize, you switch off your irrigation machines. And if you have mid-season drought, you can again switch on your irrigation machines. And I think they are actually cheaper irrigation systems for small-scale farmers. I think those are the investments that need to be made. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So, Taita, I guess that agrees a lot with the work you do. So would you care to answer that question too? So key technologies to remediate the impact.
Yes, when we look at smallholder farmers, one of the things again that is also coming up on top of the climate change is land pressure. Where the population is increasing, their land is becoming smaller. And so they need to start thinking about utilizing small spaces to increase production. So as much as we introduce hybrid seeds, we've also seen that pressure from farmers saying that we need to also increase yield within the small spaces. So we are seeing a huge push for farmers now to start moving into vertical farming, moving also to protecting their crops from unpredictable weather patterns, because sometimes it's very difficult for them to predict or get access to predictable or weather information. And so by moving them to protected environments under greenhouses, they're able to increase yield up to 10 times. They're able to use more vertical space within one small area. And that by itself allows them to be more sustainable in their production as well. The other thing also we are seeing is farmers are now starting to require data in terms of how much yield am I getting, which seed is providing me this yield, which fertilizer is providing me this. So that data point is very critical, especially when other partners come in, for example, seed suppliers or fertilizer suppliers. In order to show them that data is very important. And we hope that synergies can there be created between private sector and researchers to share this data and allow them use this data for more productive information.
Thank you very much, Taita. I'll move on to another question, and it's regarding some controversy aspects. So we know that GM crops can help with weed control, intense farming with high use of synthetic fertilizers and hag chems can help increase yields and stabilize those yields, not have variations. My question is, and starting by asking you, Carolien, can sub-Saharan Africa afford the holy grail of environmentally friendly crop production, or we are not there yet? We still have to go to the now less not as desirable chemicals and agriculture. Are we there yet with Africa or not yet?
Thanks, Pedro. Yeah, I think that sentence insinuates that use of chemicals are usually not environmentally friendly, but it can be if used correctly. So just to add on to it, I think chemicals do go through a rigorous process before it can be registered and made use of. So it's, you know, and the non-target species effects that it has are tested, and as well as the residue levels and so on. So usually when it gets onto the market, it's at that stage, it has been tested and it's safe when used according to label recommendations. So I think we need to keep in mind in the case of South Africa that it is still a country where some people don't have money to buy food. And with, I'll just say, organic agriculture yields often, not always, but often being lower than or compared to conventional agriculture, the likelihood of it being more expensive is quite good, and then the population, or the most part of the population, can't necessarily afford it. As an example, I looked at a recent survey done by the National Income Dynamics, and they interviewed a few people over May and June in 2020, and they asked them whether they are able to afford food, or at what stage will they not be able to afford food. And 47% of the people who were surveyed during that time indicated that they ran out of money for food in April. So this is in comparison to 21% of the respondent survey in the 2018 general household survey. So I think where chemicals, if there's an integrated approach being taken, that might still be viable, or that's definitely viable. And furthermore, a certain skill set and understanding of producing organic crops is required. And with the adoption of organic crop production still being quite low in South Africa, those skills and information will need to be taught and disseminated in a practical way for people to be able to produce crops that way.
Thank you very much, Carolien. Philip, would you care to discuss this subject too?
I think Carolien used the magic word there, integrated. I think that's what's needed, a sensible, balanced approach to crop protection. It needs to be a mix of synthetics and cultural control and biological control used appropriately and judiciously. It can't be all one thing at the expense of everything else. We would champion and do champion biopesticides as being more environmentally sustainable. They have to go through the same rigorous regulatory approvals. Those regulatory approvals need to become more efficient in so many countries, however, in order to deal with inherent problems, let alone emergency ones. Biopesticides need an education campaign to go with them as well, because farmers like to see the insects, the problem pest, killed on contact, but don't necessarily understand that biopesticides may ultimately have, or will ultimately have, the same mortality rate, but may take a different time trajectory to get there, but are likely to have a more sustained impact. But all of that requires an education outreach and also a production facility that's availability of biopesticides is pretty poor in many, many countries. On GM, Cabi scientifically is agnostic on GM. The science of GM is pretty sound, it's very sound. The reality, though, is more fundamental. African countries and continental Europe are very anti-GM, so there's no point espousing a technology to grow a crop that you then can't sell. Farmers will only ever sell what they can either feed their families or have a market for. So if there's no market pull, that's not going to be necessarily a way forward for smallholder farmers. And the challenge on GM, of course, is that for many farmers, it doesn't permit them to save seed, and it can be too expensive for them to afford, so that there are practical barriers for this. There is no single magic bullet, however. We need this integrated approach.
Thank you very much. As you know, or probably know, at KTN, we've been running some webinars on integrated pest management too. So yeah, that's the word, I guess, that integrated is key. Unfortunately, we are now running out of time. I had a few more questions, but we are now, I would like to thank you for your answers, and we'll now move on to breakout rooms. So everyone will have the chance to join in the discussion. We'll be splitting into two rooms. So in a minute or so, you will get a pop-up on your screen that you will need to click, and then you will be taken through your separate rooms. And at the end, we will all come back to this main room to end today's session. So without further ado, let's move on to our breakout rooms and see you shortly.